because of his sake. Keep. Save! Because of his sake. Keep. Amen? We have some softball players in the house. I might not have it just about right, but I believe I got it about right. I believe when umpires do like that, you say, is that right? Come on, help me now.
All right.
So you're saved because of his safety. My beloved, our text today is a look back and a look forward. As we look back at the year that is rapidly coming to a close, and as we look forward to the new year which is on the horizon, this is a message of encouragement to the church. Now, if you are a member of the church, you ought to be encouraged. It is also a message to those who attend church, but are not really a member of the body of Christ. It's a personal invitation to make sure that you are saved beyond a shadow of a doubt. Don't know where death is. Don't know where trouble is. It's a dangerous thing now to just go around church house. You've got to get somewhere and become rooted and grounded.
Amen.
So it's an encouragement, but it's also a message to folk who are not really active and who are not really involved and engaged in your own church. We have a lot of people who like to run the church back. I got some bad news for you. When you run the church down, you're running yourself down.
Amen.
So it is a personal invitation to make sure that you're saved. Because a lot of us believe that we are kept. And you're really not kept. Because you're really not rooted in ground. It's important that we know who has kept us down through the years.
Yes.
And not only that, we need to know who is keeping us this very moment. Who's keeping you? Is it the 8 hours of sleep you got last night? Is it your beauty rest mattress? Who's keeping you? Is it the healthy meal that you ate yesterday? Is it your job that's keeping you? Who's keeping you? We have to understand who's keeping us. Not only that, but then I need to understand who's going to keep me throughout eternity. Amen. I think I heard somebody testify this morning that nobody has a heaven and a hell to put me in. You got to know who's keeping you. Come on in here. So it's important to know who has kept us down through the years. Amen. And now that, who's keeping you this very moment? And the other thing that I need you to understand is none of us in this room are able to keep ourselves.
Amen.
Now, if you don't believe that, get sick and stay sick long enough. And what you'll find out is you'll go from the penthouse in the hospital. Come on in here. And they'll just keep moving you as your money go down. They'll just keep on moving. And pretty soon they'll send you home because your benefits have run out. Amen. So it's important to understand that we're not able to keep us. So I need to know who's keeping me. Amen. So in the text here, Peter calls those who are saved, and I need you to know that that's you. If you've been born again, he calls them the elect. Oh, come on in here. Don't you know that's special? For you to be called the elect, well, first of all, I must not know that I am the elect, because if I come on in here. It all goes together. Not only through the sanctification of the Holy Ghost, but the Bible says to the obedience of the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Don't take what Jesus did lightly at Calvary. Oh, come on in here. A whole lot of us don't even know whether or not we're sanctified yet. Hello? Let me put that to bed today. If you're born again, and you know you're born again, you're sanctified. Now you might not act like you're sanctified. Amen? And guess what? You don't have to jump up and hop on around to be sanctified either. Because your sanctification is a position in Christ. Oh, help me in here. It's a position in the body of Christ. The church is the body of Christ. Those individuals who are saved have been sanctified by the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit and have been placed in Christ. Can I preach in here? Not only that, because of that, I must be obedient to the fact that I'm saved. That's why, thank you, Holy Ghost. That's why if I'm truly saved, I ought not to act like I act sometimes. If I'm truly saved, why am I still acting like the old man? Why am I still conjuring up the old nature? If I'm saved, there has to be some obedience to the Holy Spirit. Are you hearing me, somebody? Not only that, but let me give you a few addresses. Maybe you can get with me here. Hebrews 12 and 24 and 2 Thessalonians 2 and 13. Also Romans 8 and 29. Peter blesses God. Now, a whole lot of us don't believe that we can bless God. Oh, yeah, you can bless him. Let me help you understand how to bless God. You bless God when you honor him. Oh, come on in here. You bless him when you're obedient unto him. Huh? You bless him when you yield to the Holy Spirit. Huh? You bless him when you give. Come on, talk to me in here a little while. Huh? You bless him when you say amen. Bless God. Well, Pastor, you know I'm just a little weakling. I can't bless. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. When you know who he is and when you know who you are. If you are elect, then you can bless him. Now, if you're not elect, no, you can't bless him. Are you hearing me, somebody? So Peter honors and blesses God for his abundant mercy. Anybody in here ever received mercy from God?
Yes.
Many, many times. He blesses him for his abundant mercy, which has begotten us again unto a lively hope, amen, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why you can't take the resurrection lightly. Huh? You can't take the resurrection lightly. I don't want to go to a church where the gospel is not preached. I can't deal with that. Huh? You can't take the resurrection lightly. Amen? Because if you take it lightly, then it very possibly may mean that you're not saved and you have not been begotten. And you're not elect. Hello, somebody. James 1:18 and 1 Thessalonians 4 and 14. Now, not only are we kept by the power of God as saved folks, as saints, I need you to understand that you have an inheritance. Everybody walking around talking about what I ain't got. Talking about how poor you are. And how much more you need. Well, first of all, understand that if you are elect and if you are saved, God has an inheritance for you. Are you with me, somebody in here? And guess what? Let me tell you something. If I know I got an inheritance, that's one of the things that make me act different. I'm just going to tell you. It'll make me act different. If I know I got an inheritance, if I know I got some kind that I didn't earn, and I didn't deserve, and it's by the mercy of God, yeah, that'll make me act different. So we have an inheritance that is incorruptible. Amen. And undefiled. Huh? Now you got to be careful, because you can have an earthly inheritance. And get sick. Or get a Philadelphia lawyer and get swindled out of your inheritance. Matter of fact, let me help you out. I've seen individuals and I've been in situations where individuals had an inheritance. When I die, all this is going to be yours. That's not necessarily so. Because let me tell you something. You can get sick. And while more and you think you got an inheritance, all of a sudden somebody done produced another will. I'm sorry. Well, what was that change? I got the original. No, you ain't got the original one now. They changed that one 2 days ago when here's the seal on it. That's when right out of your inheritance. Are you hearing me, please? But you have in Christ, in God, rather, an incorruptible and an undefiled inheritance that does not fade away. Folks sit around when daddy died. I'm going to get this. I'm going to get that. Let me tell you something. All of that will fade away. That's material things. So we have an incorruptible inheritance that fadeth not away and is reserved for us in heaven, huh? Just for the saints and just because you are kept by Jesus Christ. I don't know why nobody would serve because of that. And so we are kept by, what's this? That's why it's so important to have faith in God. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word. You kept according to your faith, according to the resurrection, according to Jesus' work on Calvary, and your faith in him, you are kept by our faith in God through Jesus Christ unto salvation, which will be revealed at the coming of Jesus Christ for his church. John 10 and 28. As saints of God, we are to have something to rejoice about. I've never seen so many sour mouths say before. Ain't got nothing to rejoice about at all. Nothing. Well, my question to you is, do you know you have inheritance? That ought to be enough to make you rejoice. So the issue here is that as saints, we have something to rejoice about. Even as we look around, things may not be the way we want them to be. Amen. But we still have something to rejoice about. You'll find that in Matthew 5 and 12. Now, while we're being kept, our faith is being tried. While we are being kept, while we are the elect, your faith has got to be tried. Your faith is going to be tried. That's why you hear people talk about all the problems that go on in church. They're not problems at all. Let me break it down for you. The problems that we think are problems in the church or that we identify as problems in the church is nothing more than your faith being tried. What God is saying to you is that since you are my elect, huh? Since you are my elect and I have an incorruptible inheritance for you, I need to try your faith. I need to see if you're real. I need to send you through some things to see what's going to happen to you when you go through some things. Because let me tell you something, church is not a bowl of cherries. Was never intended to be. Hello, somebody. So our faith has to be tried on every hand. But the Bible says, but to God is more precious than gold. Hello, somebody.
Yeah.
When our faith is tried, it is to be found unto the praise and unto the honor and unto the glory of God. Let me tell you something. One of the greatest times to praise God and to honor him is when your faith is being tried. That's not time to go home and pout. That's not time to go home and get dry and silent. Huh? As a matter of fact, I need to help you out. Sometime when your faith is being tried, that's the time when you praise God the loudest. You ever heard the saying about the squeaky wheel get the oil? Hello, somebody in here. Huh? So when you're being tried, huh? That's the time when you ought to praise God more. Because you're being tried, because what he's saying to me and you is, do you still trust me?
Yeah.
Do you still love me?
Yeah.
Will you still serve me?
Yeah.
In spite of. Now I know that we have some folk in the church, hello somebody, that may try to run you somewhere, but if you're born again, can't nobody run you nowhere.
Yeah.
You better hear what I'm trying to tell you, huh? In fact, just by virtue of the fact that you're running, it's probably because you're not saved. Huh? And your faith is not being tried. Amen? And so when our faith is tried, we are to be honoring God and glorifying him at the appearance of Jesus Christ. That's why it's so important to keep the faith no matter what. No matter what, I'm going to keep the faith. Amen? You know the song, I still have joy. After all that I've been through, I still got joy. That's because your faith has been tried. It's important to exercise my faith. Huh? Some of us have a dead faith. Huh? If your faith is only alive when you exercise it. Amen? And so we're to exercise our faith daily It's not a prayer. It's not a prayer. No, it's not a get down on your knees. Lord, increase my faith. No. That's not how your faith is going to be increased. The only way that my faith and your faith is going to be increased is by the word. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. That's how your faith gets increased. According to Romans 10:17, James 1:20-22, and also Psalm 66:10. Now, as we approach the end of 2014, let us reaffirm that we are still being kept by the power of God in Christ. We just studied and we rejoiced a few days ago that Jesus was wrapped in swaddling clothes.
Yeah.
And was laid in a manger. But let us be wrapped in the beautiful wrappings of Christ.
Yeah.
Huh? If he was wrapped in swaddling clothes, what are you going to be wrapped in? You're going to be wrapped in some things.
Uh-huh.
Oh, come on in here. Huh? Well, Pastor, what do I need to be wrapped in? I'm going to give this to you so that you can get it. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Let us be wrapped up and tied up with cords of divine love. Hello, somebody in here.
Uh-huh.
That's what we ought to be wrapped in. He was wrapped in swaddling clothes. We ought to be wrapped up and tied up in the cords or the bands of divine love.
Uh-huh.
Not only that, but we are to be wrapped up in the love of Christ. Hosea 11:4. As believers, we are to be plainly labeled with the seal of the Holy Ghost. Hmm? You ought to be labeled. In other words, if I'm saved, if I'm elect, I ought to look different. Mm-hmm. I ought to maybe walk in a room and somebody ought to see Jesus in me. They ought to see something different about me. I ought to be labeled.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the problem. A lot of us don't want to be labeled.
Mm-hmm.
We want to fit in, look like the world, act like the world, get along with the world, compromise with the world. Let me tell you something. We are to be labeled so that we're to be different. The Bible says we're to be a peculiar people. Oh, come on in here. Not only that, but as believers, we'll be plainly labeled with the seal of the Holy Spirit, for the Lord knows those that are his. You can fool me. You can fool somebody else. You can fool anybody you want to fool. Can't fool God, though. Because he knows those that are his. 2 Timothy 2:19. Jesus paid a price. He paid a price for me and you to be kept.
Hmm?
I want to go off the script and ask a question. Did he pay too much? Did he pay too much for you to be kept? Or did he not pay enough? The Bible says he paid a price for us to be kept with his precious blood. In other words, he paid for us to be kept with holy blood. Are you hearing me, somebody? We don't own ourselves, but we have been, the Bible says, bought with a price. You ever see folks struggling? You ever see folks struggling? That's going on? Full of arrogance? Full of pride?
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. They don't understand that they don't belong to themselves. They've been bought with a price.
Uh-huh.
And when you've been bought with a price, then that means that you can no longer operate in self. Hello, somebody in here. Hmm? So you've been bought with a price. 1 Corinthians 6:20. Now, we've got to rest on the wonderful grace of God. Ephesians 2:8. We must be waiting for the appearance of Jesus Christ. What are you waiting for? I'm waiting to get paid. I'm waiting for church to be open. I'm waiting for my paycheck. I'm waiting for a birthday. We're waiting for a whole lot of things. But one of the things that we ought to be waiting for is the glorious appearing of Jesus Christ. The Bible said that he's coming back just like he said he would. You'll find that in Philippians 3:20-21. Our way to heaven is a guarded way. Huh? God has guarded the way to heaven for his elect. Now, if you're not the elect, hello? The way to heaven is not guarded for you because you're not going. Hmm? But the way to heaven is guarded and guided by the elect, by the angels of God. Luke 16:22. God has guaranteed our safe arrival to heaven. If you are saved, guess what? Your amen, John 10:28. And not only that, your arrival will be registered, huh? Special delivery. Do you hear me, somebody? Your arrival and my arrival will be labeled and registered special delivery, and it will be insured. You ever send something through the mail? First thing they ask at the post office, do you want insurance? What is the value of what you're mailing?
Yeah.
Well, I stop by to tell you that if you're a child of God, your delivery to heaven has been registered and it is insured. 2 Timothy 2:19, Psalms 92:11-12, and Ephesians 4:30. As a matter of fact, we're sealed by the Holy Spirit when? Until the day of redemption.
Uh-huh.
Are you hearing me, somebody? Now, because we are kept for safekeeping, the Word of God tells us that we are now sons of God. Amen? But yet, it does not yet appear what we shall be like. Amen? But we know that we shall be like him when he appears. Amen? And so what I'm simply trying to tell you is that you're kept if you've been born again.
Uh-huh.
And what keeps me and what keeps you is a hill called Calvary.
Yes.
What keeps me and what keeps you is a manger in Bethlehem.
Yes.
What keeps me and what keeps you is God's only begotten son, but Mary's baby. What keeps me and what keeps you is the blood of Jesus that was shed on Calvary.
Yeah.
Huh? What keeps me and what keeps you is out on a hill called Calvary.
Yeah.
The Bible said that Jesus hung from the sixth hour to the ninth hour.
Yeah.
Well, he didn't have to hang for himself. He didn't know any sin. He was not sinful. He was sinless.
Yeah.
And so he became a sin sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
He hung out on Calvary for the safekeeping.
Yeah.
Now, what makes us elect and what makes us kept safe is when we put our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ as Lord. Are you hearing me, somebody? The moment that I accept him into my life, he sends the Holy Spirit to live inside of me, to keep me, and to seal me until the day of redemption, until the day that he comes back for me. And so it is because of Jesus that I'm kept. In 2014, there are a whole lot of things that could have happened. There are a whole lot of things that would have, should have happened. And the only reason that they didn't happen was because we were kept safe. Are you hearing me, somebody? They used to have a praise chant in the old Landmark Church.
Mm-hmm.
And they used to talk about, it is the good Lord's blessing that I am now enjoying.
Yeah.
And they used to sing a song about there's a man down at the river.
Yeah.
And he's giving sight to the blind.
Yeah.
Well, and then somebody else struck out on a song, oh, to be kept.
Uh-huh.
And so I stopped by to tell you on my way to heaven that it's good to be lit. It's good to be different. It's good to be saved. It's good to be kept by the power of the Lord. Well, the only way that he could keep me and the only way that he could keep you is he had to die. He had to shed his blood. He had to suffer. And he had to die. And when he died, the Bible said he hung his head in the locks of his shoulders. And he gave up the ghost. He gave up the ghost. They took him down and laid him in Joseph's new tomb 3 days and 3 nights. But early on the third day, God raised him from the dead. This is what I like about it. When he raised him from the dead, he raised him with all power in heaven and earth in his holy hands. I stop by to tell you that one who has all power is able to keep. You don't hear me? I stop by to tell you that when you are kept by the power of the Lord, death cannot hold you. The grave cannot hold you. Enemies cannot hold you because you are kept by the power of the Lord. We have a whole lot of scared saints. They're scared to die. I stop by to tell you, if you're going to be with the Lord, you've got to die to be with him throughout eternity. I'm not wishing and I'm not in a hurry to die, but I realize that I've got to die in order to live forever. Not only that, but I stop by to tell you, if you are elect, you ought to kill some things every day. The Apostle Paul said that I ought to mortify some deeds of the flesh. There are some things in my life. There are some things in your life. You ought to be busy mortifying. You ought to kill some things. You ought to kill lying tongue. You ought to kill a gossiping lip. You ought to kill a stealing hand. You hear me? But there's some things that I ought to kill because of who I am. I stop by to tell you, on my way to heaven, you got to know where you're going. The year 2014 is almost over. I stop by to tell you, it's not promised that we're going to cross over and see 15. Yesterday is gone. Today is right now. And tomorrow may not come. But I stop by to tell you, are you kept by the power of God? Are you kept by His blood? Have you been sanctified? Have you been washed in the blood of the Lamb? I need you to understand that you got an inheritance that's waiting for you. Well, I'm going to leave you alone here, but I'm waiting and I'm watching. I'm just waiting and I'm watching. I don't know when, I don't know where, but He said He was coming back again. You don't hear me? My mind runs back in the book of Acts when Jesus was about ready to go back to heaven. You had folks standing around looking up at the sky. Why stand you mean here gazing in the sky? This same Jesus is coming back again, just like He said He was. And so I'm looking for His return. You don't hear me? When I look around, I see a whole lot of false teaching, a whole lot of false prophets, a whole lot of false doctrine going around. And so you got to be careful that you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I don't know about you, but I'm looking for Him, the one that John said got hair like lamb wool. Oh, you don't hear me? I'm looking for the one that John said got eyes like balls of fire. I'm looking for the one that John said, you don't hear me? Feet like polished brass. I'm looking for the one that John talked about, the one that walked around with a rainbow around his shoulder. You don't hear me? The reason he got a rainbow wrapped around his shoulder, because he promised, you don't hear me? He promised that I'd never destroy the world by water, but we find this time. So I'm going to have a rainbow wrapped around my shoulder, so you will know that it's me. The time is winding up. You don't hear me? Every day, every hour, every moment, a new religion, a new prophet, a new person, a new thing is popping up. You've got to be sure. man wants to die, then after that, there's the judgment. I know a whole lot of folks have gotten all the way down to the 29th and a half year. I know some folk that got all the way down to 6 months from retirement. And God said, come on home, it's all over.
Yeah.
Do you hear me, somebody? You trying to get a gold watch. You want a flat. Huh? You want somebody to pat you on the back. You want a retirement card. Come on in here.
Yeah.
We've got to look at some things and understand who's doing the keeping here. It's the good Lord's blessings that we enjoy. And then we want to hand God a Baptist doctrine. Huh? Have you ever thought about how many raises the Lord allowed you to get? You ever thought about that? Working on a job? You ever thought about how the Lord, how good? I just heard your brother say, I've been promoted 2 or 3 times.
Yeah.
Being kept
by
the keeper.
Right.
And so what we have to do, all I'm simply saying is give God the glory that's due. Give the Lord credit for something.
Yeah.
Huh? Let's give the Lord credit for something. I know you're a mathematician. I know you're a scientist. Amen. I know you're an English teacher or whatever, but give God credit for something.
Yeah.
Give him credit for keeping you.
Yeah.
I got to leave you alone. The door of the church is open. I didn't intend to preach this coming. But I need y'all to get with me. Hmm? If you get with me in 2015, I can be in and out. Huh? But if you sit up and look like you're sleeping tired, huh? You just make me preach hard. It is what it is. Huh? If you can't say amen, huh? If you can't say preach, pastor, huh? If you can't do nothing else but look at your Bible and look at the same thing I'm looking at and say, you're right. God bless your heart.